your peace, and your love. We pray, Lord God, that you would calm every heart, that every storm would be stilled, that every need represented here would be met. Pray, Lord God, that from this point we would know that we are being led by you. And Lord God, where we have strayed, we pray, Lord God, that as we reflect on your goodness and love to us, that, Lord God, we would ensure that we seek to walk on your paths, in your ways, in such a way as to glorify you and to reflect our professed love for you. But Lord God, we are conscious that we fail, that we disappoint, but we thank you, Lord God, that you are loving and merciful. So Lord God, we pray that you would forgive us for our weaknesses, cleanse us of our sin, forgive us for our wavering, dithering, perhaps even fear, especially for speaking up for you. So Lord God, in this world of turmoil, we thank you that we can be here and experience your peace, for which we give you thanks and praise. Amen. Amen. Shall we stand? We'll sing the hymn, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, oh. Heir of salvation, purchased of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture have burst on my sight. Angels descending ring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Should we take our seats and we'll have the Bible reading, please?
Today I'm reading from Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 to 20. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things are created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. and he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross.
Thank you, Miriam. Shall we stand if we're able to? And approach his throne.
My grace alone, somehow I stand. Where once I would have feared to tread. Invited by redeeming love, before the throne of God above, he pulls me close with nail-scarred hands into his everlasting arms.
When condemnation
grips my heart, and Satan tempts me to despair, I hear the voice that scatters fear. The great I am, the Lord is here. The one who fights for me and shields my soul eternally. Boldly I approach your throne, blameless now I'm running home. By your blood I come, welcomed as your own, into the arms of majesty. Behold the bright and risen sun, more beauty than this world has known. I'm face to face with love himself, his perfect, spotless righteousness. A thousand years, a thousand times are not enough to sing his praise. Boldly I approach your throne, blameless now I'm welcomed as your own, into the arms of majesty. This is the art of celebration, knowing we're free from condemnation. Oh, praise the one, praise the one, only I approach your throne, blameless now I'm running home. By your blood I come, welcomed as your own, into the arms of majesty.
So please take your seats. Pat is going to lead us in our prayers.
Thank you.
Good morning, friends. Matthew 11:28 reads like this. Jesus said, "Come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest." I don't know how you're feeling this morning, but I think we're all aware that there are many people today carrying heavy burdens, great concerns for their family or for the way the news is going. We all get discouraged and we all just wonder, Lord, what is happening? But let's just think about these words. The Lord wants us to turn to him, to realize he's got it all in hand. He knows your burden. He knows that thing that immediately comes to mind that you're concerned about. He knows all about it. And he wants to just comfort you this morning and make you aware that he's here. We're coming to the right person for the answers. So let's trust him this morning and let's thank him first of all, and then let's pray and seek his face for those needs that are on your heart, on my heart, and the various ones here today who really are burdened. Let's pray. Father God, we do thank you that we can approach your throne this morning in and through the lovely name of Jesus, our Savior and our Lord. And we thank you that he knows us, each one. He knows those burdens, those anxieties, those things that come immediately to mind. And, oh, Father, we just pray for each one this morning that is feeling burdened, concerned, anxious. And we as brothers and sisters just want to lift each one to you, praying, precious Lord, that you'll be very near. And that, Lord, you would just give that awareness that you've got it all in control. And that you're going to take them through, that you're going to meet this need in the name of Jesus. And we do think further away, Father. We think of so many people who are struggling today. We think particularly of those who are persecuted. And you know about this news that we've heard just recently of all these poor people in Nigeria that have had to rush away from their homes because of the attack. And the fact, dear Lord, that on Christmas Eve, 295 people were killed. And Lord, that many homes were burnt to the ground and 30,000 people were displaced. Oh, Father, when we hear news like this, we are so saddened. But gracious Lord, we pray for the dear ones that are left, those who've lost loved ones, those who are brokenhearted. Oh, Lord, we pray that as they call upon you, they will know that you're with them, that you're giving them the strength, that you're going to take them through, and that, Lord, you will, Lord, meet their need in the precious name of Jesus. Then, Father, we think of Israel once again, and your word tells us to pray for the peace of Jerusalem, and I'm sure many of us have. And, Father, we just confess we don't quite know how to pray, but we do know that your lovely word says in the Lord's Prayer that, Lord, your will be done as it is in heaven, so shall it be on earth. So, Lord, we pray that your will be done for Israel. And we pray, Lord, we add wisdom. Oh, Father, please undertake and meet the need of your people there. And may many of them, Lord, recognize Jesus as the Messiah. So, Lord, we return to our home and to Clevedon, and we pray for all who are lifting up the name of Jesus today, that, Lord, great glory will be brought to him, and people will call upon him and come to know him as Savior and Lord, because we ask it in his precious name. Amen.
Should we stand together if we can?
Were creation suddenly articulate with a thousand tongues to lift one cry? From north to south and east to west, we did Christ be magnified. Were the whole earth echoing his eminence, his name would burst from sea and sky. From rivers to the mountain tops, we take Christ, we magnify. Christ be magnified. Oh, Christ be magnified. Let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. When every creature finds its inmost melody, and every human heart its native cry. Oh, then in one enraptured hymn of praise, we'll sing Christ be magnified. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. I won't bow down to idols. I'll stand strong and worship you. And if it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice because you're there too. I won't be formed by feelings. I'll hold fast to what is true. If the cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. Because death is just the doorway into resurrection life. If I join you in your sufferings, then I'll join you when you rise. And when you return in glory with all the angels and the saints, my heart will be the same, and my song will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified. Let his praise arise, Christ be magnified in Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. When I stand before your throne, dressed in glory not my own, what a joy I'll sing of on that day. No more tears or broken dreams, for God is the minor key. Everything as it was meant to be. And we will worship, worship. Forever in your presence we will sing. We will worship, worship you. An endless hallelujah to the King.
I will see you.
I will see you as you are. Love you with unseeing heart. See how much you paid to bring me up. Not till then, Lord, shall I know. Not till then, how much I owe. Everything I am before your throne. And we will worship, worship. Forever in your presence we will sing. We will worship, worship you. An endless hallelujah to the King. No more tears, no more shame, no more sin and sorrow ever known again. No more fears, no more pain, we will see you face to face, see you face to face.
We will worship,
and we will worship, worship. Forever in your presence we will sing. We will worship, worship. An endless hallelujah to the King. And we will worship, worship. Forever in your presence we will sing. We will worship, worship you. An endless hallelujah to the King. An endless hallelujah to the King. We'll sing an endless hallelujah to the King.
Amen. Something to look forward to, isn't it? Should we take our seats and we can hear from Levi?
Good morning, everyone. Hope we're all doing well on this lovely Sunday. A bit cold, but hope we're all doing well. So, this morning, as Miriam read so beautifully, we're going to be looking at Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 to 20. Now, have you ever wondered how perfect and complex our bodies are? A digestive system which converts food for muscle growth, a body which repairs itself when damaged. The brain, which is beyond our comprehension, controls our every move, thoughts, functions, and feelings, sending billions of bits of information throughout our body every day. Yet with such perfection, which only God created himself, man is so imperfect. In Psalm chapter 139, verse 14, it says, "I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made." Now there are many different examples in which the human body is so complex and so precise. Yet to fathom something so common, such as childbirth, for example, can be too much. And yes, we may know that A plus B equals C, but it's a little bit more than that. To think that a mother can have another human, a child, inside her own body, growing inside, being sustained just as the mother is herself, to then one day be born and become just like us. Now, did you know that a female body is born with all the eggs that she will ever have in her lifetime? So when your grandmother was carrying your mother in her womb, you were a tiny egg in your mother's ovaries. Fun fact. And another example is that God has created us with the capacity to keep learning until the day that we die, which is something that we shouldn't take for granted. It is said that the average brain weighs about 3 pounds, which is the same as 1.3 kilograms or the size of a standard laptop. but yet, neurologists approximate that we have the ability to learn something new every second of every minute of every hour of every day of the rest of our lives. There's more facts. Another fun fact. Did you know that it was discovered in 1998 that our blood vessels are not just straight, but they actually have a slight twist, as known as a helical or spiral? And the evidence for this demonstrated that the spiral of the vessels makes the blood flow more evenly compared to straight vessels. And to think that as humans, we're only capable of living because of the perfection of the earth, the correct distance from the sun, the earth's atmosphere, the correct amount of oxygen in the air and the earth's orbit. These examples lead me on to the sermon today, which I'm calling A Perfect God. But before we do, shall we just pray? Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for bringing us all here this morning. Lord, I thank you for this church, and I thank you that we can look to your Son, Jesus, as the perfect example that ever lived. Lord, and we know that we are not good enough, but we thank you that we can lean and trust in you. Thank you for sustaining us, for the breath in our lungs. And Lord, I pray that you would speak to us this morning, and that our hearts would feel changed. In Jesus' name, amen. So the context of our passage this morning from Colossians, it's the 12th book in the New Testament, written by Paul when he was in prison. Now, Paul wrote this letter to the church in Colossae after a guy called Epaphras was the man which started this church in Colossae. And he came to him in prison to discuss his concerns about the cultural pressures that his people were facing within this church tempting them to turn away from Jesus. And so this letter that Paul wrote to them was an encouragement for them to keep their faith and turn towards the Almighty God for his guidance. Now, today's passage is a poem taken from chapter 1, verses 15 to 20, and it's all about the Messiah. And I just want to read it again for you. It says, "He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross." Now this morning I want to discuss this passage, and I've broken it down into 3 points, but the first point is going to be the main point today, which is called the perfect God, which is followed by the second point, the imperfect man, and finally, the perfect solution. So as we look at our first point, the perfect God, there are many ways in which we know God is perfect through his creation, through his perfect plan, his perfect sacrifice, and God himself. Simply put, God is infinite. Even the very first verse in the Bible, Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." Unlike creation, God does not have a beginning or an end. He has no limitations. Psalm chapter 147, verse 5 says, "Great is our Lord and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure." So no matter how hard we try to measure God, he will always go beyond us. And I think that is why we often may not talk about the perfection of God. And perhaps we think of it in our minds that God is perfect. Yep, we get that. I understand. But maybe that's it. Maybe we don't dig that little bit deeper. And I think perhaps the reason for this is that because no one will ever truly understand. And as humans, we have limited lifespans, and we make choices on how we spend our limited time and resources. And even then, just look at how imperfect we are. And I think that's why it can be most difficult to comprehend maybe what even perfect looks like. God's infinity is a result of his greatness. And as many of us know, God is known for being omnipotent, meaning that he is all-powerful, omniscient, meaning that he is all-knowing, and omnipresent, meaning that he is present everywhere at all times. Now, John chapter 1, verses 1 to 3 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made." If the Lord cannot be measured, then there are always limits to our understanding of him. Now this should only make us humble as we recognize what a God we serve, a God that stands over us and all creation, even going far beyond all our understanding. After all, it does say in Genesis chapter 1, verse 31, "God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good." So the first verse from our passage this morning is verse 15, where it says, "He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation." Now, Paul here is referring to Jesus, the image, which can be known as the likeness or the resemblance of the invisible God, the firstborn, God's only son, of all creation. It's interesting that the word image that Paul uses here, it involves more than a resemblance, more than a representation. He is God. Although Jesus took on human form, he has the exact nature of his Father. And I think that's important to make that very clear. And I, when reading and preparing for this sermon, I found this quote from a guy called Arthur Peake, who was an English scholar. And he said this, "God is invisible, which does not merely mean that he cannot be seen by our bodily eye, but that he is unknowable. In the exalted Christ, the unknowable God becomes known." I just thought that was a really powerful quote. And we can see that Paul chose his words very carefully, as they hold so much meaning. We know that the invisible God became visible in Christ. We know that Christ is visible, audible, approachable, knowable, and available. And we know that all that God is, Christ is. I feel that the emphasis here, though, is that we can know that God, we can know God truly, but not fully. But we know that through Christ, he is always there. Now, towards the end of this verse, in verse 15, we read, "the firstborn of all creation." It's interesting that the word firstborn here, and it might seem like the most suitable word since God and Christ was the firstborn, but it has more than a literal meaning. Now, in biblical culture, a firstborn had status, which usually also came with a greater share of inheritance. However, it was not necessarily the oldest child, which was the firstborn. Firstborn often referred not to birth, but of rank, therefore expressing Christ's supreme status and sovereignty over all creation. Christ created the world, saved the world, and rules the world. He is the head of creation. So as we go on to verse 16, it goes on to say, "For by him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him." Now I want to focus on the first part of that verse there, which says, "For by him all things were created." And the reason for this is that it links back to the facts that I shared at the beginning. And Paul is very clearly stating here that there is no doubt that Jesus is the author of all creation. For even he himself is not a created being. And it is when we understand and behold the wonder of his creation that we worship and honor him all the more. Now I have a few more examples and some fun facts to share, which you might be pleased to hear. Now, did you know that the planet Saturn, the one that's most famous for its rings around the planet, the rings are known to be 500,000 miles in circumference. But did you know that they're only about 1 foot thick? Another fact, the Earth travels around the Sun about 8 times the speed of a bullet fired from a gun. There are more insects in 1 square mile of rural land than there are human beings on the Earth. And finally, a single human chromosome contains 20 billion bits of information, such that if it was written in an ordinary book, it would take about 4,000 volumes. In verse 17, it brings us back to the point that I raised in verse 15, saying that Paul understood that Jesus is fully God. And it says, "And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together." Christ is the originator, and no one comes before the Creator, and in Christ all things are held together. Whilst reading this verse, I tried to think of an analogy, something that would link to this verse, as in when I was reading the part, "all things holding together." And I came up with this, and actually it kind of happened yesterday. So in the analogy, you've got your washing, it's upstairs, it's in this big pile, and you want to take it downstairs. Now, the one option is to go downstairs, or to take it in small piles, taking it downstairs. The second option would be go and get the laundry basket, put it in the basket, take it downstairs. But what is the most likely option, which I think we've probably all done here before, is to try and take it all at once without the basket as much as you can, bringing it all together. And does it always work? Maybe, probably not. You probably lose a sock here and there on the way down. But the important point is, not only is God holding all things together, there is not one mistake or person who is left out. Everything is under control. God is perfect. I heard of this phrase whilst preparing that says, the permanence of the universe rests on Christ far more than on gravity, such that it is a Christ-centric universe. So as we go on in verse 18, it says, and he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. Christ is the source of the church. Without Christ, there is no church. And here at CFC, church is us coming together as a family, as brothers and sisters in Christ, worshipping, praying, and glorifying God's holy name, just as we have done this morning. And everything we do here is to honor and glorify God, because without him, we are nothing, and church would have no meaning. The second part of this verse refers to the resurrected Christ, Jesus as the status of the firstborn of creation. Being firstborn from the dead means that he sits at the head of this new family over whom death has no power. We are to become followers of Christ, and when we choose to follow him, we are adopted into his family and have the joy of eternal life with him. And at the end of this verse, in verse 18, it says, in that everything he might be preeminent. Now, the biblical meaning of the word preeminence is the highest place of ascendancy, above all, over all, surpassing all, to the point that nothing and no one else can ever come close. In some other translations, in the NIV, it uses the word supremacy, and in the NLT, it uses the phrase, so he is first in everything, all meaning that Christ is sovereign and above all. As soon as we look into our final verses, verse 19 to 20, it says, for in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. In other words, for in Christ the fullness of God dwells in him. They are one and the same. Goes on to say, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of the cross. We don't make our own peace with God. It is Christ who made peace for us through his work on the cross. Christ who took the punishment for our sin. Christ who gave his life for us on the cross, just so that we could be forgiven from what we have done. And one day, so that we can meet him in heaven. Now, this leads us on to our second point this morning, talking about the imperfect man. And as we know that scripture's saying, we've discussed this morning, God is perfect, and there is no doubt. But where does that leave us? God is perfection. We are not. God created the universe. We did not. God is outside of time and space. We are not. God made the ultimate sacrifice, his one and only Son. Yet we struggle to even share. God created us so that we could populate the earth. Yet there is abortion in the world. God has a plan and a purpose for our lives. Yet so many cause self-harm. God is infinite. We are not. Yet we live for money and materialism, which we can't take with us. God gave us the perfect solution, yet so many do not accept or believe it. We are certainly not perfect beyond any stretch of our imagination. We have all fallen short of the glory of God. But God knows that, and he has not given up on us. God provided the perfect solution, which is our final point this morning. And as our passage, written by Paul, has explored the deity of Christ and his perfection, we can know that God provided us this perfect solution. And without Christ, we would be nothing but mere mortal humans with no life, no purpose in life, and we would be lost. God honored Adam and Eve all the way back in Genesis when they were in the Garden of Eden. He honored them by giving them free will, the chance to do right. They could do anything they wanted except one thing, to not eat of the apple from this one particular tree. And as they did, after being tempted by Satan, sin entered the world, separating us from God, always trying to tempt us and draw us away from him. So God made the ultimate sacrifice. He sent his one and only Son to this earth to take on flesh, enter into the world that he created, the very image of God, to live the perfect life, to bring healing, miracles, hope, love, and peace. But for Christ, knowing what was going to happen eventually, he knew what was going to happen, that he would be sent to this cross not for his own wrongdoing, even replacing an unrighteous man, a criminal named Barabbas, at the same time. Christ had to carry his own cross to the place where he would die, in the most horrific way possible. He was mocked, attacked, tortured, and beaten, being hung on the cross for all to see, just for us. There were even those shouting at him while on the cross, "You who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from that cross." They were tempting him. Jesus knew that. He knew that it was that easy. He had the power to step down from that cross. But he also knew that it wasn't the Father's plan. Christ died on that cross, sinless, taking the punishment for which we deserve, the ultimate display of grace. God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is infinite in power, presence, wisdom, and perfection. So to summarize, just as we have looked at the perfect God, the imperfect man, which is us, and then the perfect solution, are you going to make the best decision in your life to love, serve, and follow Christ? And if you have done so already, don't think you're getting away so easily, because are you living for Christ each and every day? And maybe you want to make that decision for yourself today, and praise God for that, and it's such amazing news if you do, and please come speak to me afterwards, or speak to anyone that you know, as we'd love to celebrate with you. Or maybe you've recently made the decision, or even maybe you've made the decision a long time ago. And I want to encourage those who haven't been baptized to consider it. As it says in Acts chapter 2, verse 38, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." Baptism is for when you have made that decision for yourself. It's a symbol of dying to sin and being raised up into new life with Christ. And it's a great way to invite family and friends to witness to them. And so I just wanted to close with a few verses from Psalm 104, starting with verses 5 to 14. "He set the earth on its foundations. It can never be moved. You covered it with the watery depths as with a garment. The waters stood above the mountains. But as you rebuked, the waters fled. At the sound of your thunder, they took to flight. They flowed over the mountains. They went down into the valleys, to the place you assigned for them. You set a boundary they cannot cross. Never again will they cover the earth. He makes springs pour water into the ravines. It flows between the mountains. They give water to all the beasts in the field. The wild donkeys quench their thirst. The birds of the sky nest by the waters. They sing among the branches. He waters the mountains from his upper chambers. The land, it is satisfied by the fruit of his work. He makes grass grow for the cattle and plants for people to cultivate, bringing forth food from the earth. In verses 31 to 35. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. He who looks at the earth and it trembles, who touches the mountains and they smoke. I will sing to the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. May my meditation be pleasing to him as I rejoice in the Lord. But may sinners vanish from the earth and the wicked be no more. Praise the Lord, my soul. Praise the Lord. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for your love for us. Thank you, Lord, that you are perfect in all things. Thank you, Lord, for your perfect creation. Heavenly Father, I just pray that we can look and turn towards you this morning and thank you for everything that you have done for us. Thank you for your wonderful creation. Thank you for our lives. Thank you for sustaining us. And thank you for your work on the cross so that we could be with you one day in heaven. Lord, we just thank you. We thank you again for who you are. And thank you, Lord, that we can know your perfection. And thank you, Lord, that you are above all. In Jesus' name, amen.
Should we stand together? The nations rage, kingdoms rise and fall. There is still one king. I will not fear, for this truth remains, that my God is the Ancient of Days. None above him, none before him, all of time in his hands. For his throne it shall remain and ever stand. All the power, all the glory, I will trust in his name. For my God is the Ancient of Days. Though the dread of night overwhelms my soul, he is here with me. I am not alone. His love is sure, and he knows my name, for my God is the Ancient of Days. None above him, none before him, all of time in his hands, for his throne it shall remain and ever stand. All the power, all the glory, I will trust in his name. For my
my God is the Ancient of Days. Though I may not see what the future brings, I will watch and wait for the Savior King. Let my joy complete, standing face to face in the presence of the Ancient of Days. None above him, none before him, all of time in his hands. For his throne it shall remain and ever stand. All the power, all the glory, I will trust in his name. For my God is the Ancient of Days. For my God is the Ancient.
Amen. Should we take our seats? Our steward is going to lead us as we share communion together. Oh, he's at Sunday school. Can someone get Stuart, please? Unless I hand over to you, Ian. Maybe someone could let Stuart know that he doesn't need to come. Thank you, Ruth.
Working? Yeah. Lord, we do thank you for the privilege of being able to come to your table, Lord. Being able to take the bread and the wine, your blood, your body, the symbolism, and yet there's a realism there. Lord, we offer our hearts and our minds to you, Lord. Do as you can, Lord. Renew us for another week, another period of time. Help us to face those things that we need to face this week, and help us to come before you on a daily basis and cleanse ourselves, Lord, by just giving ourselves to you. Help us to walk closer and be nearer. In Jesus' name. Amen. Can I ask Liz and Rob and maybe Jackie and Trig to help me? There you are, Jackie. Caught you. And would you like to help us here?
Thank you. faith will fail, Christ will hope be fast. When the tempter would prevail, he will hold me fast. I could never keep my hope through life's fearful path, for my love is often cold. He must hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. Those he saves are his delight. Christ will hold me fast, precious in his holy sight. He will hold me fast. He'll not let my soul be lost. His promises shall last, bought by him at such a cost. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. For my life he bled and died, Christ will hold me fast. Justice has been satisfied, he will hold me fast. Grace with him to endless life, he will hold me fast. Till our faith is turned to sight, when he comes at last. He will hold me fast, he will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so, he will hold me fast.
He will hold me.
He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. When I fear my faith will fail, Christ will hold me.
Should we stand if we're able?
When the tempter would prevail, he will hold me fast. I could never keep my hope through life's fearful path, for my is often cold. He must hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast.
For my life
he bled and died,
Christ will hold me fast. Justice has been satisfied. He will hold me fast. Raised with him to endless life. He will hold me fast. Till our faith is turned to sight. When he comes at last, he will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast.
So, Lord, we pray that we would hold on to those words of truth, Lord God, that you won't let us go, that we are safely in your hands, and that you will usher us into your wonderful, perfect kingdom one day, when we will see you face to face, and when you will complete the work that you have started in us. So we thank you, Lord God, that between now and then, your mercies are new every morning, because you're faithful. Thank you. Amen. Amen. Shall we take our seats? I have just a few announcements. We have Lift at 5:30, so that's the junior youth here at 5:30. The senior youth, the group has called themselves Illuminate. They're going to let the light of Christ shine into their lives, and the light of Christ is going to shine out. And that's what we want our young people to be and to do. And so we'll be meeting at 7:30 here. If you want more information, please speak to me or Hamish or Levi or Isabella or Jack. And there'll be some food on put on as well, some games, and we're going to look at a couple of verses of scripture together. Tomorrow there is it's just toddlers, isn't it? Toddlers between 10 and 12. And then football down at the school at 8 o'clock. We had a very good win yesterday, 6-2, against Bedminster. So congratulations, boys. On Tuesday there's Come for Coffee between 10 and 12. We have an evening service here between 7:30 and 8:30, time of fellowship, prayer, praise, and a look at God's word. And then Wednesday, the ladies' group restarts at 10 o'clock, between 10 and 12. So I think Ella is leading it this week from recollection. If you're free, please just turn up here. Ian is leading a men's Bible study in tandem with that between 10 and 11:30. So they just go straight upstairs to the upper room where they have a chat and time of fellowship. On Thursday, if you're interested in choir, have a chat with Holly over here. You have a practice at 7 o'clock. And if you're not involved and you like singing, why not come along? I'm sure you'll enjoy it. And then we have no other activities until then next Sunday, except for Thursday night. That's right. Next Thursday night, this Thursday night, yes, you better have. That one. Sorry.
Okay, so Thursday night, women, we are getting together again for Bible study. For 8 weeks, we're doing the Kelly Minter study on finding God faithful. And now, if this frightens you or you think this is academic, it's not. Last year we did Daniel for 12 weeks. That was academic, I'm not going to lie. It wasn't it. It was brain stretching, but it did us good. We did Esther just before that. That was great. This one's an 8-week one. You all get a journal. It's not just about stretching our brains in Bible study. It's about stretching our hearts as well. Thursday night is a really lovely sisterhood, to be honest. We get a chance to pray together and be together, journey together, life together, all of that. So if you haven't done it before, come along And if you can't make it every Thursday, if that frightens you, I can't do every Thursday. It doesn't matter, because everything is available online. But come and journey with us, women. It's a wonderful study coming up, and I can thoroughly recommend it. And every single woman in this room and beyond is welcome. So please come along, 7:30 Thursday night, and there's always cake. Okay, so good.
Right. Jack, would you mind handing out some of the instruments for the children? Men's breakfast. 8:30. At the Bridge Inn in Yatton, 8:30. If you're not already enrolled for the men's breakfast, please speak to Rob. Rob, would you stand up and wave your hand so everybody knows? Come on. So last time I saw, we had over 20. Is that right? We've got, I'm sure they were. We'll have to take money in advance. 25 already then are coming. If you're not coming, you are more than welcome. So please speak to Rob and get your name down. And I'm sure it would be a great time. Sadly, I can't make it, but I'll be there at the next one. I promise. I say I promise. I will do my best. Right, children, do you want to come and help us with this one? My Saviour, my God. My Saviour lives. My Saviour loves. He's always there for me. My God, he was. My God, he is. My God is always going to be. Should we stand if we're able? In time with the drums, boys. Ready? Are you ready?
I am not skilled to understand what God has willed, what God has planned. I only know at his right hand stands one who is my Savior. I take him at his word and deed. Christ died to save me, this I believe. And in my heart I find a need of him to be my Savior. That he would leave his place on high and come for sinful man to die. You count it strange, so once did I. Before I knew my Savior, my Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God is always gonna be. Yes, living, dying, let me bring my strength, my soul is from this spring. That he who lives to be my King once died to be my Savior. He would leave his place on high and come for sinful man to die. You count it strange, so once did I. Before I knew my Savior, my Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me.
My God, He was, my God, He is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God is always gonna be. Yes, living, dying, let me bring. My strength, my soul is from the spring. That He who lives to be my King. Once died to be my Savior.
Right, shall we finish with the blessing? May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn His face towards you and give you peace. Amen. I forgot a couple of other announcements. Congratulations to Marlene, permanent permission to remain, or whatever the phrase is. So that's great news, and great to see you as well, John. So congratulations. We thank God for that. On